Oh, that one. Please direct your attention in midfield as Mary Chirico will throw out the honorary first throw. A big thank you to Mary Chirico for joining us tonight. We hope you enjoy the game.
Good evening, everybody. This is Dennis Michelson coming to you high atop Benedetti Worley Stadium here on the campus of North Central College. It's time for Chicago Wildfire Ultimate. And joining me up in the booth this week, Meagles! It's great to see you, Megan. It's great to have a professional back at the mic.
Well, thank you very much. It's good to be back alongside you, Dennis. It's been too long.
Missing a couple of key players from the Wildfire lineup tonight. Ross Barker, Kirk Gibson, Nikki Gallini not playing, but the Wildfire is going to be very excited to have Nate Goff back. Opening pull, and Pavlyanis, middle of the field with the disc. Firing it up to midfield. They're going deep. Wide open, but challenged for the disc in Pittsburgh, making a good play to knock it away.
Causing Pardo to misread that disc. That's the kind of play that Pittsburgh really needed to come out with early in the game. They have had the unfortunate ability to come out very slow this season. So to have any chance against this Wildfire squad, they're going to have to punch one in right now.
Very sloppy handling of the disc there as they throw it out of bounds. And the Chicago Wildfire will take over just about 20 yards out from their goal. Early action here at Benedetti Worley Stadium. We're just underway with 11 minutes and 11 seconds to go. Max Trotter on the disc for the Wildfire. Pavel looking for a cutter. Working the disc around in the middle of the field. Weiss now, Nick Zhao into the end zone for the score. That's Mike Pardo for his first tonight.
That was some fantastic patience from the Wildfire outside of the end zone. Some hot defensive pressure from Pittsburgh. And again, they were really looking to come out with some different defensive looks to try and shake things up for the Wildfire. But Chicago showing some resilience early in the game, punching that in a very disciplined fashion.
One thing I noticed when we were down on the field before the game, a little hard to read the wind out here at North Central College. Appeared to be pretty calm, but down on the field, a little bit of a swirl, not too dissimilar to what we've had over the last few years at Lane Tech. So I think the boys are going to get along really well with this new stadium. Pittsburgh going on offense. Mast, Van Dusen, and Watt will be your handler line. Working the disc up past midfield. At Shepard. Fires it up the middle. Nobody's seeming to get open for Pittsburgh here. The Wildfire the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds moving the disc. About 15 yards out. Now fires towards the end zone to Shepard. Shepard makes the catch, but just shy of the end zone. Wildfire defense trying to recover, firing the disc all the way over to the right hand side of the field. Now advancing it up. Mast into the end zone for the score.
Go ahead. A few throws shy of that score, Mast was really forced to throw a very tricky inside out to Shepard. Shepard catching, straddling the line. You know, Pittsburgh managed to maintain possession of the disc that particular point, but that's the kind of defense that is going to generate opportunities, that is going to generate turnovers. Talking with Coach Adrian King prior to the game, he mentioned that they know Pittsburgh is short-staffed tonight. They have only 19 players. The general manager and the head coach are both cleated up tonight. That's how few individuals they had for tonight's game. So they're looking to make things very difficult for Pittsburgh on offense. And that's something that Pittsburgh has struggled with so far this season is offensive productivity. They're coming in at just 56% tonight. So that's the kind of play that Chicago is going to continue to need in tonight's game.
Max Trotter on the attack for the Wildfire. It's 1-1 early in the first quarter. Deep into the end zone for the score. Danny Miller with the play, and it's 2-1, Wildfire.
Well, I'm talking about keeping the offensive tired. That's another thing that's going to make things very tricky for Pittsburgh. When Chicago answers back that quickly, putting the Pittsburgh O-line back on the field so soon after they just labored through a point, you know, Pittsburgh is going to have to score a little more quickly, a little more efficiently, but the Chicago defense is looking good so far these few points.
Very strong start to the game by the Wildfire. 2 weeks ago in the home opener out here, the Wildfire just looked a little out of sorts. They just couldn't seem to get a good consistent attack, maybe opening night jitters out here. But now, very good crisp passing of the disc tonight, and the Wildfire off to a good start. Nice long hole hanging pull. How important is it for setting up the defense to get those nice long pulls?
Well, we saw that was exemplary, that particular point. Every Chicago Wildfire player was able to get down on their assignment before the disc even fell into Pittsburgh hand. So they got themselves into prime position to make things tricky from Pittsburgh before they even threw their first pass.
Good recovery there by Shepard. He now tries to throw it deep, but turfs the disc, and the Wildfire will take over. I thought for a minute that we had a foul call there, but no call. Wildfire will take over right at their own end zone. Opening night, the D-line had a little trouble doing much with the disc when they did get the turnover, but they're steadily moving the disc up the field here against a pretty loose Pittsburgh defense so far.
I'm excited to see what we'll see from Jason Valley, number 94, tonight. This is his first game in the AUDL, first game with the Chicago Wildfire.
And right on cue, Valley for the score!
So far, I am impressed. Coach King mentioned how excited he was about this player in particular. He said Jason brings a certain level of dynamicism and athleticism to the team. Don't be surprised if this rookie makes you notice him early.
We saw that last year with a lot of players that had really strong debuts for the Wildfire. Jeff Weiss, who's now a very integral part of both the offense and the defensive scheme, when he came out and against Pittsburgh, ironically, last season for his first game in the AUDL, he had a big game. I was talking to Jason before the game. He tweaked his ankle in practice on Thursday, but the ankle looked pretty good from up here.
Follow Giannis with the pull for the Wildfire.
3-1 Wildfire, 8:15 left in the first quarter, and Pittsburgh really needs to come out with a good offensive possession here. Disc looked like it was going to be kind of stolen out of the Pittsburgh handler's hand there by Max Trotter. They'll march off 10. Pittsburgh still with the disc. Working the disc up the right-hand side. Now going deep. Floats it towards the end zone and the score. Nice play by the Pittsburgh defender against Pittsburgh cutter against two Wildfire defenders, and it's 3-2.
And that was head coach Pat Hammonds with the catch. Certainly unhappy that he's had to cleat up tonight, but getting out and putting some stats under his name.
I was giving him the business before the game when I was talking to him. I said, hey, tell me a little bit about this Hammonds kid. I haven't seen him in the lineup for a while. He said he's got some old legs, but he can still get it done.
Clearly, even in double coverage.
.738 left in the first. 3-2. Your Wildfire ahead. Not much of a wind out here tonight, Meagles. I don't think we're going to see a big difference between the attack upwind and downwind.
Yeah, as you mentioned earlier, a little bit inconsistent, but certainly not a big headwind, tailwind.
Pavel going deep, and he's got his man for the score. Nate Goff snuck away wide open, and Pavel right on the money for the score, 4-2 Wildfire.
Pavel doing what he does best, launching big bombs that are easily catchable by no one but the Chicago receiver. As you mentioned earlier today, Chicago still missing Kurt Gibson, who really hasn't had the opportunity to make the impact Chicago was hoping that he would make in the game. But Nate Goff, certainly fantastic to have him back and healthy again. And not taking too long before he's making an impact in tonight's game as well.
Nate was taking it real easy in warm-ups tonight. But when I asked him, he said he was ready to go 100%. This was a regularly scheduled game off for Kurt, so he gives him one more week to get those injuries all healed up for that big game next week against Madison. That's going to be quite the game out here next week against those dreaded Madison Radicals.
Yeah, that rivalry has been fun for years, and as Chicago's strength has ebbed and flows over the years, hasn't been as contentious, but I think it's going to be a big one this weekend.
Shepard going deep, but the Chicago Wildfire defense there to knock it away, and the Wildfire will take over deep in their own end. Wildfire seems to be really reading the disc well on defense. Jeff Weiss with the disc, working it back around to the center. That's Woods. Woods up the right-hand side. Sakura deep into the end zone for the score. Nice play by Jeff Weiss.
I like what you said earlier about Jeff Weiss being such an instrumental part of the Chicago Wildfire squad. And it is funny, I completely forgot that last year was his rookie year, and you and I were calling the game when he had his breakout game, making everyone recognize his name. Yeah, just been super fun to watch this kid grow and develop even more, but he was such a ambitious player from the moment he has stepped on the field. He's always a fun, exciting player to watch.
Only about his fourth year playing the game of Ultimate, and each game you see him play out here in the AUDL, he's reading the plays, and he's getting more of a, I like to call it a higher Ultimate IQ. He's got the athletic ability, but he's really starting to understand this version of the game of Ultimate.
That's a good point. He is learning, and he seems to be doing it at a faster rate than a lot of athletes tend to.
5-2, your Wildfire with the lead, and Pittsburgh throwing one carelessly away, and the Wildfire will be on the attack again. Wildfire D-line trying to get it going. Deflection of the disc there. But I thought there could have been a foul call there, but no. Pittsburgh will take over. Going deep, but too deep. That disc will fall harmlessly out of play in the end zone, and the Wildfire will quickly take over possession. So was that a case of Pittsburgh just getting too greedy, or was that a good shot to take right there?
You know, I think it was a good shot to take. Certainly, the timing was a little bit off. thrown just a moment too early, which is why it landed so far from the intended receiver.
Timeout on the field. Coach Adrian King wants to get the offense back out there. It's the Chicago Wildfire 5, the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds 2. .517 left in the first quarter. You're the good guys, the boys in blue, up 5-2, and Pavel Giannis will take over the disc. They can blow this one wide open here.
As I mentioned earlier, this is something that Pittsburgh has struggled with so far this season, maintaining the kind of offensive intensity and clarity necessary to keep in the game. They've let big breaks happen early in all of their games. Looks like this game is going quite similarly unless they pull out a huge stop here.
Good quick motion with the disc. Pardo in for the score. That was an impressive play by the Wildfire.
That was, and some very nice movement just outside of the end zone between Pavel Giannis, Mike Pardo, and Jeff Weiss. Some pretty quick, very difficult to defend movement that kept the disc flowing nicely straight into the end zone. And as I was saying, this is really what we've seen from Pittsburgh so far this season. Their offensive line makes just a few too many mistakes. The opposing team is able to attack. And remember, not every break has been a single possession on the side of the Wildfire. The Wildfire has definitely given the disc back to Pittsburgh, but they've made a second error, and then Chicago has pounced.
I like the way the Wildfire attack is going tonight because they're not worried about playing that small ball. They're taking what the defense is giving them, and they're being very, very aggressive. And it's showing right now on the scoreboard. Good start for your boys in blue. Toll with the disc. Back to mast. That's Vats. Up to midfield, working the left side of the field. Van Dusen back into the middle. Van Dusen firing deep. He's got his man out there but cannot make the play.
Yeah, that was a pretty tricky shot. That was a tough read for Mast, and obviously the angle and the speed put it just outside of play. Mast is a fast player. It's certainly that he wasn't quick enough. It was just the combination of it being at a tough angle as well as the speed of the disc that made it tricky for him to catch.
Wildfire quickly turning over the disc. And Pittsburgh will get a second chance here. Deep in the Wildfire end, firing into the end zone, laying out for the score. Impressive play. Van Dusen with that great layout catch. And it's 6-3 Wildfire.
Well, Chicago's mistakes lead Pittsburgh to keep this game within a sizable margin. Three. So much more manageable than if Chicago had extended their lead by 5.
That ended a 3-0 run for the Wildfire, but that's something we did not see in the first game of the year for the Wildfire. They were having a hard time putting more than one score together. It just was impossible for them to get much going against Indianapolis. Tonight against Pittsburgh, much different story.
Rodgers with the pole for the Thunderbirds.
Your starting offense for the Wildfire going back on the attack. Pardo to Weiss. Looking for help. Back to Max. Going to get back in the hands of Pavel Giannis. Weiss doing a great job of cutting back to the middle of the field, kind of opening things up. But the Wildfire disc got knocked out of the hands of Pavel Giannis. Foul called. This is where Pavel's very dangerous with a wide open field. In for the score. Beautiful play. Nate Goff getting open, then firing it into Pardo for the score. It's 7-3, Wildfire.
I'm sure Pittsburgh was hoping for slower offense from Chicago at that point. They came out with a zone look that I don't think we've seen from them before. But, you know, it's really hard to trip up a player like Pavel Giannis. Pavel is such a creative handler, both in terms of the throws that he puts and the way he sees the field. You've also got someone with rising ultimate IQ in Jeff Weiss. He was there capitalizing on every gap that the Pittsburgh defenders opened up. It really did not take too much time or effort for Chicago to advance the disc against that zone.
Weiss and Goff doing a great job of coming back to the disc in the center of the field. That's leaving Pardo to do what he does best. And that's three on the night already by Pardo here in the first quarter. Yeah, so far this season, it's been Danny Miller and Ross Barker leading the way for scoring for the Wildfire, but I think Pardo wants to make up for that tonight. He's looking to have a big game. Disc knocked out of the hands of the Pittsburgh handler. And Shepard on the disc midfield. Toll. Shepard with the disc. Oh, a great diving play, knocking the disc out of play. It looked like Slimer. Michael Egan with the play for the Wildfire. Judah Newman. Firing for Leverson.
Nice find by Newman.
Oh. Downfield. Disc knocked out of play by the Pittsburgh defender. He was pretty well covered there. I wasn't much of an opening to throw at.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. Newman found Leverson on the closed side of the field, getting things open when the offense had just started to stagnate, and then when things were moving pretty nicely through to a very covered individual.
Pittsburgh down to 30 seconds here in the opening quarter. Shepard with the disc. Now time running against Pittsburgh here. 18 seconds left. Open the disc up the right-hand side. Now firing deep across the field. Wildfire defender stumbled. Pittsburgh with the score. That was Vats with the play.
And that was Valley with the stumble, so perhaps Jason Valley's ankle is bothering him. It looked like he was both in position and had the speed to make a play to stop that Pittsburgh score from happening. As you mentioned, with just a few seconds left in the quarter, that would have been a huge stop for Chicago.
7-4 Wildfire. Right around 6 seconds left. That's plenty of time for Pavel to go deep here. Good solid start for your boys in blue tonight. Little chilly, but we're getting a break in the rain. Looked like we had more of a chance for an arc building contest earlier today, looking at the radar, but it's kindly giving us a break. Zhao going deep as time expires. That'll be the end of the first quarter with your Chicago Wildfire 7, the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds 4.
Contestant number two. Oh, just a little high. A little wide right. Ooh, close again. Ooh, even closer. Not so much that one. Just over the top. All over it.
Welcome back to Benedetti Worley Stadium out here on the campus of North Central College, the new home of your Chicago Wildfire. Just about to start the second quarter, and the boys in blue are up by 3-7-4. Meagles, I was very, very pleased with that Wildfire offense in the first quarter. Nice, crisp passing, but taking the deep shot when they had it.
Yeah, when you stretch the field like that, it can make it very difficult for the defense to make adjustments and try and close off part of the field. They have to honor both the long look and the short game, so it keeps the defense on their toes a little bit more than if you favor one over the other.
Mixing up the D here, you got Pavel Giannis, Max Trotter, and Woods in with a lot of the defenders. They can get the turn here. They're going to have a lot of firepower to come back at them.
That looked like a clean D from Jeff Weiss. I'm not exactly sure what the call was. Perhaps it was a foul against the thrower. Looks like Max Trotter's on the mark.
Pittsburgh with the disc. Another whistle. Well, it was a stall count against the Pittsburgh handler.
Stall against Pittsburgh.
You were talking about how pleased you were with the Chicago offense. I've been really pleased with the Chicago defense. They really made Pittsburgh think twice about the long throw. So as I was mentioning earlier, when you shut down half of the field, it can make it so much more difficult for the opposing team to gain any momentum, gain any traction. Pittsburgh has been very tentative with their longer puts because of the Chicago defense. And it's not necessarily a single individual, but good, solid team D that has led to a few turnovers.
Pavel with the disc to Max. Back to Pavel. We're going to disc up the left-hand side of the field. That's Woods. Back to Pavel, back to Woods. Nothing coming open downfield. Playing a little pitch and catch out here. Now firing it deep. And it Wentz with the play. Jeff Weiss, the kid they call Wentz, with a nice play on the disc, and it's 8-4, Wildfire.
And a great throw from Nate Goff. You saw him put just enough inside-out touch on that disc that it pulled away from the defenders and started to bend back in towards the middle of the disc to the precise point that Weiss was cutting.
One of the things I think that the Wildfire missed in their home opener out here was Coach Adrian King was not here for the game. And Coach is a wizard at making the adjustments and getting some fresh legs into the game and knowing the right combinations to have some good firepower out there, and it paid off with that possession.
And he's such a calm, reassuring presence that when things are not going the way that you expect them to, when you have someone like Coach King on your sideline, you feel a little more secure, a little more like anything is possible. What about
Jimmy Sikora with a great defensive play, then into the end zone for the score. And that was Jeff Weiss again. That's his third of the night.
Of course, Sikora has to get credit for that D. He ran in, made the play. I am a little surprised that the Pittsburgh handlers put up that throw with a player like Sikora in such close proximity.
A lot of good disc hawks on this Wildfire team on the defense. And when you let a little bit of air go under that disc, you're just asking for trouble, especially deep in your own end. Jimmy Sikora pouncing on the disc, and Weiss quickly making that move into the end zone to get open for the score. Very impressive start here to the second quarter for the Wildfire, and now they're up by five.
I'm going to borrow that term, Dennis, disc hawk. That's a good one.
So that's the advantage of having like an ultimate novice up here in the booth. I can come up with some new terms for you. Pittsburgh on the attack. Working the disc up the right-hand side, Toll. Back to the swinging to the left-hand side, Shepard, then around. Whistle on the play. Looks like Drew Leverson came up a little bit gimpy on that play. Pittsburgh will take over. Van Dusen into the end zone. Nice layout for the score. Is that Vats on the play again?
Yeah, that was.
David Vats with a nice layout for the score. That was an impressive catch.
That was an impressive put. It was low. It was fast. It went over the entire stack. I was sure some Chicago defender was going to make a play on it. It seemed to be so low hanging. But it seemed to be, I guess, just high enough and just fast enough. And no one was quite expecting it, and it landed in the hands of a Pittsburgh player.
9:29 left in your second quarter. Chicago Wildfire 9, the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds 5. Looks like the starting O out there for your Wildfire here for this possession. Pavel put the disc into play to Mighty Max Trotter. Back to Pavel. Those two are a dynamic duo out here. Weiss again coming up to the middle of the field to keep the play going. Open things up again. Pavel up the left-hand side now into the end zone. Going deep for Goff. Goff snatches it out of the air over two Pittsburgh defenders for the score.
Couple of things I really like that point. First of all, Zhao being down a little bit farther into the field enabled him to gain more yards, so they didn't have too much distance to go to make that score. Exhibiting a lot of faith in Goff with that toss. Goff didn't have that many steps on his players, and of course the disc perhaps a little loftier than Zhao intended allowed Pittsburgh enough time to come up onto it and make a play, but not enough of a play to outplay a player like Nate Goff.
Great to have Nate back, and he is looking healthy tonight. That's the exciting part of a player by like Nate Goff. He's so dynamic on the offensive side of the disc, but also such a great defender as well. Pittsburgh at midfield. Firing it up. Up the right-hand side, right down to the goal line. Whistle on the play. Ref marking off 10 against Pittsburgh. Firing it into the end zone for the score. Not much that your Wildfire could do there, and Van Dusen will get the tally.
Sam Van Dusen with the score for the Thunderbirds.
Yeah, that's pretty tough. Prior to that throw going off, I was really impressed with the defense from the Wildfire. Someone streaking fast across the front of the end zone. Able to shut down that throw, but as you mentioned, that strike cut is incredibly difficult to guard. When you get that close to the end zone, if you're not fast enough to react, then it's a surefire score for the opposing team.
Looked like the Wildfire was trying to force the action on the disc, and the Pittsburgh handler made a nice play to push the advantage into the end zone. If he had tried to swing the disc back to the middle of the field, I think the Wildfire was waiting for that. But a nice play by the Thunderbirds to cut that lead down to 4. Pavel Giannis looking over the field. Working up the left-hand side to Zhao. Zhao to Weiss. Back to Pavel. To Max. Back to Pavel. Very patient offense here by the Wildfire, just taking what's there. Now Weiss opening up the field a little bit to Goff. Back to Max. Little pitch and catch with Goff again. Max pushing up the right-hand side to Pardo. Down to Goff. Right into the end zone for the score. Impressive play by your Wildfire.
And yet again, Chicago burns Pittsburgh with their zone offense. You know, there are a couple of things that are essential to working the disc well against a zone. The first being patience and the second creativity. You have to understand that cuts may not look the same as they do from a single throw to a single throw. And Chicago is willing and ready to make the adjustments necessary to find the open lanes as opposed to hoping they're in a particular place. The other thing that's really helpful, you mentioned it earlier, the dynamicism between Max Trotter and Pavel Giannis. These two individuals work so well together. And I really like how Max Trotter is developing as a player. Last year, I feel like he was merely Pavel's support staff, but this year he's expanding his capability, his looking downfield, and it's really making him a much more valuable handler for Chicago.
One of the things they did early in the season before the injury bug hit was they were using Max to sort of anchor that defensive line as a handler, and boy, did that give the D-line a lot of explosiveness. Max has all of the throws, all of the great plays, just like Pavel, but he's a great role player, and he'll do the job that he's needed to do, a very valuable part of this Chicago Wildfire team. Going over the top. Toll into the end zone for the score. That was number one. Good old Max Shepard on the score. Getting it back to four.
That hammer toss to Toll hung just a little too much. Slimer, number three, Mike Egan, thought it was a surefire D, and so he pulled off of his individual, leaving the Pittsburgh receiver just a little too open in the end zone.
6:54 left in your second quarter out here at the new home for your Chicago Wildfire on the campus at North Central College. And here's the great thing, folks. Come out to North Central College to watch the game, and then an easy walk over to the bar after the game from here. Max Trotter to Pavel. Pavel's always looking to push that advantage up the field. Weiss back to Pavel. Up the left-hand side to Goff. Exploits the middle of the field of Mighty Max to Pavel. Back to Max. Max working up the right-hand side to Pardo. Back to Goff. Almost looked like the Wildfire was getting a little careless with the disc there. Weiss. One thing that really impresses me with Weiss is he also can make some pretty good throws. Firing it deep, but too deep and out of play. Pardo knew as soon as he threw that disc that he was in trouble. Seven Wildfire, 5:49 left, but Pittsburgh, if they can come up big here, they could put a little fear into the old Wildfire here. Long throw, though, and easily knocked out of play by Pardo. And the Wildfire will take over. Pittsburgh getting a little greedy. Pavel Giannis will put the disc back into play. Zao hanging it up, and Pittsburgh picking the disc off now. Whistle on the play, and Pittsburgh will take timeout. So with 5:03 left in the second quarter, it's Chicago Wildfire 11, the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds 7.
The finest gloves in Ultimate. If you wear gloves while playing Ultimate, make sure to stop by the merchandise tent to pick up your own pair of Friction gloves. Visit them online at frictiongloves.com.
Pittsburgh back on the attack. Welcome back. It's D-Mike and Meagles back together again. They got the band back together. Out here at Benedetti Worley Stadium, 5 minutes left in your second quarter. Pittsburgh knocking on the door, firing the disc into the end zone for the score. That looked like Van Dusen on the play.
It certainly was. The throw from Max Shepard You know, that's a pretty rough spot to make a mistake. And of course, the throw that led to it was the high throw that Danny Miller wasn't able to pull in, giving Pittsburgh the disc in very prime position. Called a timeout, set themselves up the way they wanted to offensively, and played it well.
11-8 now. Pittsburgh back within three. And this becomes a very important offensive possession for your Wildfire. Just under 5 minutes to play here in the second quarter. Pole going out of bounds there for Pittsburgh. Wildfire will take over in the middle of the field. How important is it going to be as the game wears on with a thin roster with Pittsburgh to be chasing these nice, long, aggressive offensive plays by the Wildfire?
Well, keeping the game close is going to be to their benefit, and in this second quarter, they've really done a good job of just that, making sure that they manage their offensive points well, that they hold on to the opportunities that are put in front of them. These games are long, and when you're on the road, you arrive just a little more fatigued, a little more tired. So managing each play, each point appropriately is going to put them in the best position to keep this game close in the fourth quarter, which is going to be a tougher quarter for Pittsburgh.
Pardo had thrown the disc away, but he quickly got the old D there to get it back and give the offense for the Chicago Wildfire new life. Danny Miller back to the middle to Pavel, up to Weiss. Weiss's size really opens up the field here in the middle of the play. Him and Goff together is a good combination on that cutter line. Pavel knocking on the door for the Wildfire, fires it into the end zone for the score, and that is Jeff Weiss with his fourth of the day. Good balanced attack here tonight by your Chicago Wildfire. Four goals for Jeff Weiss. Mike Pardo with three. Two apiece for Danny Miller and Nate Goff.
You can feel the intensity starting to increase just a little bit. Those offensive points that looked a little calmer, a little crisper for Chicago in the first quarter are starting to look a little more harried the second quarter. I think Pittsburgh is finding their sea legs, so to speak, adjusting the type of pressure they're putting on this Chicago team, making it just a little more difficult. And that's evidenced in the score. Whereas the first quarter we had 7 Chicago, 4 Pittsburgh, both teams stand at 4-4 right now.
Pittsburgh going on the attack. Watt going deep. Disc hanging. Fighting for position and a nice play by the Pittsburgh offensive player. That looked like Beardsley on the score.
Beardsley, just a little more veteran than the young Jason Valley. Reading that disc a little bit better, you saw him and Valley really jockeying for position as they tried to read exactly which way that disc was bending. Beardsley read it just a little bit better. You noticed by the time the disc came down, Valley was at Beardsley's back, unable to make a play.
3:24 left in your second quarter. Wildfire 12, Pittsburgh 9. Pavel and Max working the disc quickly up the field. Pavel to Weiss. Again, Weiss cutting across the middle to open things up. And now the Wildfire on the attack. Goff back to Pavel. Working up the left-hand side. Now moving back to the center. Goff to Zhao. out of reach of Jeff Zhao there, and Pittsburgh will take over.
It was a nice poach D from Alex Thomas on Pittsburgh.
Now Pittsburgh tries to work it back over to the middle of the field. Almost a little careless there. Now going deep with the huck. Pittsburgh offensive player just could not come down with the play, and your Wildfire will take over. 2:22 left here in the second quarter. Your Wildfire back on the offensive attack. Pavel. Timeout called.
Timeout Wildfire.
2:09 left in the second quarter. It's Wildfire 12, Pittsburgh 9. We'll be back in a minute. Mike and Meagles back here at Benedetti Worley Stadium on the campus of North Central College. We're 2:09 left in the second quarter. Your Wildfire up by three. That timeout there just kind of looked like a few of the players were gassed, but maybe just not sure what we were doing there.
Yeah, I really think that the offense has started to stagnate a little bit because of the adjustments that Pittsburgh has made. I also think that number nine, Pat McMullen from Pittsburgh, is making things really difficult for Pavel. He's a pretty bothersome defender. But you see there, they took a moment, caught their breath, talked things through, and that looked like classic Chicago offense. Right, things stretched out appropriately, no one having to force anything, being able to use both the length and the width of that field, and another big throw from Pavel Giannis puts one back up on the board for Chicago.
The fifth score of the day for Jeff Weiss, and one of the things I noticed with that kid is he's learning a lot from Mike Pardo on how to just kind of sneak away from the defense and get himself open. Nobody does it better than Pardo, but Weiss did it right there where he just didn't – he looked like he was cutting back to the middle of the field, and then all of a sudden just sprinted open. Pavel saw him get that step on his defender, and just a great throw and catch by the Wildfire, and they put it back up by four. Pittsburgh deep in their own end now. Working the disc to the left-hand side, but out of play. Owen Watt could not secure the disc, and the Wildfire now will take over. Neil Phelps will put it back into play. Zukowski, Newman, and Phelps. So where Chicago might have wanted to have that last timeout left here, but the D-line doing a pretty good job of maintaining possession. Inside of a minute, Phelps with the disc. Phelps going deep. Two offensive players there, but two defenders there for Pittsburgh, and they knock it out of play.
Yeah, not quite enough velocity on that toss. So it just sort of hovered right at the end zone line instead of flying deep into the end zone, making it easier for Chicago to catch.
Pittsburgh now deep in their own end. They need to get something here to finish the second half strong. Long pitch and catch. Toll with the disc. and he'll call timeout. 17 seconds. We'll keep it right here. 13-9 Chicago Wildfire. How important is it to finish the half strong here for Pittsburgh?
Okay, so here is a classic example of the end of quarter situation that can really make or break a game for a particular team. Chicago didn't have to do anything but maintain possession of the disc. They have a very sizable lead. They could have just kept playing catch with one another and let the time run out if it didn't look like they were going to be able to score because Pittsburgh defense was pretty tight. Instead, an errant throw from Neil Phelps gives Pittsburgh the opportunity to make a play. And we get a quick long shot from Pittsburgh. Now they have the disc just outside of their end zone. It is huge for them to make this point. And they have plenty of time to do it. 17 seconds is plenty of time. Even with some intense defensive pressure from Chicago, they can volley the ball back and forth between themselves for a little bit, waiting for something to open up downfield. If they could close the gap to a three-point lead, this is going to put them in great position to make a strike in the second half. So Chicago has to get a stop here.
Pittsburgh will put the disc back into play about 12 yards out from the score. That's Shepard on the disc. Firing it up and into the end zone for the score. That's Vats, David Vats, good old number four with the score. And it's 13-10, Wildfire.
Well, we have seen Chicago do more with less time. So we'll see what play they pull together here with 17 seconds left in the first half.
Lots of time for that Chicago offense to finish the half strong here. Pick up your pair today with satisfaction guaranteed or your money back. 13-10 Wildfire, just about 17 seconds left here in the first half. Pavel putting the disc into play to Max. Quickly back to Pavel. Pavel to Max. 10 seconds left. Max to Pardo. Pardo to Weiss. Weiss. Time running out. Pavel over the top. Into the end zone. Almost a great play there. But the disc goes out of play. And that'll be it for the first half here. At Benedetti Worley Stadium, where it's the boys in blue, the Chicago Wildfire 13, the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds 10.
Sit back and enjoy all the halftime fun and hilarity as contestants compete in the Dizzy Back competition. The contestants will get dizzy by rotating around a bat and then attempt to throw a disc into the target can. Should be a lot of fun. As always, bathrooms and merchandise are located underneath the grandstand.
I'm in.
Rock it.
Okay, let's get the first two contestants up there and get busy. On 3, 2, 1, go. Get the second set of contestants up there and get dizzy on 3, 2, 1, go. Two winners ready and get dizzy on 3, 2, 1, go. Congratulations, and thank you to all of our contestants for competing in the Dizzy Back competition.
Throw to the break side.
Firing into the end zone. Nice defensive play.
After practice, he'll be there doing ladders by himself. I remember one of the first practices we had. He was out there doing ladders in the snow.
AlleyCats turn over the disc. The Wildfire coming up. Big Sakura down just outside the goal. Flips it into the end zone for the score.
Play something very, very simple. Generally, you'll find that the D lines don't have as many set plays as the offense, and so I don't think it's coincidence that they both ran the same exact play.
AlleyCats tried for a deep play there, disc picked off by the Wildfire, but a whistle on the play. Now they'll go deep. Got a man out there, but the Chicago Wildfire. Fires it up the middle of the field to Pardo. Pardo in and out of the hands of the AlleyCats player. Up with the play in their own end zone. That could have been a disaster. Now they'll fire it deep. Hanging up in the air in the Wildfire.
Moves. Sometimes you can do it from a juke or a quick burst of speed out after a throw.
It's halftime out here at Benedetti Worley Stadium where the Chicago Wildfire up 13-10. North Central College, the new home for your Chicago Wildfire this year. And Meagles, the AUDL season this year, it's like somebody just spun a big old wheel. And some of the teams that you expect to do great, not doing as great. And some of the teams that you kind of are going, what the heck are they doing being in the game? But we're seeing a little bit of that tonight as well around the league.
We are, and you know, it's opening up a lot of interesting storylines about what makes an AUDL team great. And as with any sport, it changes from year to year, depending on the chemistry of a certain team, the capabilities of a certain coach. But we've been seeing a lot more buy-in from a number of different teams, and it's resulting in great parity in all of the divisions, making things a little bit more of a just a crapshoot.
It's amazing to me how you can add two or three players to a team or subtract just one key player, and it really changes the whole dynamic of a team. And we're seeing it with our Chicago Wildfire and even seeing it tonight. Jeff Weiss making his first start of the year and having him be able to fill the middle of the field, sort of taking turns with Goff in that role, has really opened up things for the Chicago offense. And, you know, we're seeing a lot of that same sort of dynamic with one or two key players being added all around the league this year. It's made it for a very, very exciting season. Check out theaudl.com. And don't miss the game of the week with our really outstanding announcers that are there to cover all the games. That would be you, Meagles.
Why, thank you very
along
much.
Along with Evan. Evan is fantastic on the call, and you guys are always entertaining. Next week, I am looking forward to seeing the big showdown between Chicago and Madison. That should be a big game of the week.
That will be a big game of the week, and a little bit different. We'll have three people in the booth next week. It'll be Evan, myself, and the one and only Chuck Kindred on the call.
Fantastic. Wildfire putting the disc into play. Just starting the third quarter here. Going deep. Pardo up for the play and makes the score. Mike Pardo showing why he's one of the best in the AUDL with the big score.
No rest for the weary Pittsburgh offense. Back on the line right away. That was a quick strike from Chicago. I'm going to give credit to Coach Adrian King for a good locker room talk. I don't have any intel. I don't know that that's what happened, but I'm going to suspect that that's what happened because Chicago in the first quarter of this game looked pretty strong, confident, moved the disc quickly. The second quarter, things started to stagnate a little bit. To come out that prepared, that intense, is clearly the product of someone having given the appropriate advice during that 10-minute break.
Good long pass there, or throw for the score. And that was just one of those who wants it more type of things. The Pittsburgh defender was in great position, but Pardo just outplaying him for the disc.
Yeah, Damicus. good at defending, good at reading the disc, but like you said, Pardo did a better job of keeping his body positioned to make the play.
Pittsburgh going deep here, but a great defensive play on the disc. Jason Valley again with a nice, impressive play. Your Wildfire will take over here. Captain Jack. Jack Shea with the disc. Back to Jimmy Sikora. Sikora threw that disc into traffic and knocked away by Pittsburgh. They'll take over. Pittsburgh laying it up into the end zone, but a great recovery by Jimmy Sikora getting in the way and making that a tough play for the Pittsburgh Cutter. Disc goes out of play and the Wildfire will take over.
I'm going to give credit to Valley for that D as well. Max Shepard was going in hot in pursuit, was about to make the play, but Valley's presence caused him to misread the disc.
D-line quickly on the attack for Chicago. Dave Woods, one of the reliable handlers here on the D-line. Jack Shea to Jimmy Sikora. Sikora back to the middle of the field. Captain Jack. Ooh. Working the disc up the left-hand side. Kingma into the end zone for the score. Nick Zeman with his first of the night.
That was a great put from Kingma. He had to wrap it around his defender, Max Shepard, in order to make that disc playable for Chicago.
15-10, Chicago back up by five. Good start here to the second half for your boys in blue.
Now going into this game, what I thought were the keys for Chicago was to not beat themselves. You know, I really think, you know, I think Pittsburgh is a great team. I think they've had the capability. Oh, it looks like there was a call.
So they're taking the goal away from Chicago. Not sure what the call would have been on that play.
Yeah, not sure either, but
Kingma will put the disc back into play for your Wildfire. Floats it into the end zone for Captain Jack Shea. And it's 15-10, Wildfire.
Thought you liked that point so much, we might play it again for you just a little bit differently. The result is still the same. Chicago up by 5 points. And going into this game, what I personally thought were the keys for the game for Chicago was to not beat themselves. We've seen them underperforming so far this season. And in that second quarter of this game, Chicago made a few mistakes that Pittsburgh was able to capitalize on. The kind of mistakes that in a game against an opponent that's clicking a little bit better than Pittsburgh is so far this season, could potentially cost them the game. So I like the adjustments that I've seen in between the first half and the second half so far. This is the way Chicago is going to need to play consistently against opponents like the Minnesota Windchill, the Madison Radicals, in order to be as impactful as a team as they want to be.
After we've seen the first half of action here today, just how good can this Wildfire team be this season when they're at full song with guys like Ross Barker, Kirk Gibson, and Nikki Gallini added to this roster?
You know, I really think that they can make a play to win the division. That's a really tall order given how good Madison has been consistently. They have held so many of their top players year after year. They are really firing on all cylinders. So I'm not coming out and saying that I think that Chicago can beat them outright, but I do think that they could make a bid to do so with the addition that they've had this season. Nick Goff playing well, and Kurt Gibson with huge potential.
Pittsburgh turning the disc over, and your Wildfire quickly on the attack down towards the end zone. Goes over the top into the end zone for the score. Wide open. That looked like Ben Mechalala had. Bruno!
Speaking of additions, Grant Zukowski is someone who has played for Chicago in the past, recently moved back from Seattle. He's a veteran player who they are no doubt glad to have back on the squad. He brings with him so much experience, so much capability, firepower-wise. That hammer, great evidence of what he's capable of doing and the kinds of puts he's able to find on the field.
Wide open to Bruno for the score. Yep, I'm not even going to attempt that last name the rest of the season. 16-10 Wildfire. And I think C.J. O'Brien just tries to bring in a couple of name ringers to give the announcers trouble. Pittsburgh on the disc, 8:32 left in your third quarter. Working the disc up the left-hand side. That's Vats. Whistle on the play. Players look a little confused, but looked like a traveling call there. Oof. Whistle on the play. That looks like a foul that was called against Pittsburgh. Now suddenly from midfield, two penalties. Now they're deep in their own end. Oh, thrown up for grabs there, but Pittsburgh making a good recovery on the disc. Rummelhardt almost coming up big. Pittsburgh looking a little shaky on this possession, but maintaining the possession. Good aggressive defense by your Wildfire. Working up the left-hand side. Goes over the top. Into the end zone for the score. It looked like Beardsley on the score.
Max Shepard kept that point alive for Pittsburgh. He was working tirelessly to continue to get open. He's a tough assignment for Chicago. He's really wily, good at getting open. And then, as we saw evidenced with that hammer put to Beardsley, good at making the big throws when necessary. So both with his legs and with his throws, was kind of a one-man show, that offensive point.
That puts the end to another run, another 3-0 run for Chicago. Get them back up by six, but now Pittsburgh cutting it back to five. 7:02 left in your third quarter, 16-11. Good guys. Chicago back on the offense. Pavel to Max. Max Trotter back to Pavel Giannis. Pavel back to the center of the field to Weiss again. That really opens up the offense with Weiss coming back to the disc. Max and Pavel, a little miscommunication there, and Max throws the disc away. Pittsburgh will take over, and they quickly throw it right back into the hands of Pavel Giannis. Weiss to Danny Miller to Weiss. Little fast break, Chicago style, into the end zone for the score. Mike Pardo on the score, but it was Weiss and Danny Miller that opened that up.
You know, I didn't even think it was possible for Trotter and Giannis to miscommunicate, but we're allowed to quickly erase it from our memory with Pittsburgh's blatant error of throwing it directly back to Giannis, and Chicago very quick to capitalize, as we saw with that give-go the speed with which they marched the disc down the field left Pittsburgh reeling. They had absolutely no opportunity to put on a mark whatsoever.
Pavel looked a little surprised that the disc was coming right at him.
I know,
is that kind of the toughest play in Ultimate, where you're not expecting the disc to be thrown right at you when you're on defense?
No, because, you know, at worst, if you knock it down, then it's still your team's possession. I think it's much worse when it's happening in a zone and you get the disc surprisingly thrown to you.
Chicago back up by 6:17 left in your third quarter. Good try for the disc by the Chicago defender. Shepherd with the disc, going deep. He's got his man wide open, but good recovery by Chicago to knock that disc away. Just seemed to be floating a little bit. And Chicago quick to come back for the play and knock it away. Now Chicago will take over. Chicago on the attack. D-line being nice and conservative here. Whistle on the play. Foul called on Pittsburgh. .505 left in your third quarter. The boys in blue up by 6. Now the D-line here. They can be heroes and get the score. They blow this one wide open. Egan tries downfield. Pittsburgh, nice defensive play. Now they'll go back on the attack. Pittsburgh going deep, but too deep. That one will fall harmlessly into the end zone.
Yeah, it looks like Max Shepherd was intending to throw to Mike Egan.
Yeah. Chicago up by 6 in total control here in the third quarter. Newman going deep. He's got Leverson out there. Nice play on the disc by Drew Leverson. Back to Egan. Into the end zone for the score.
Nice sneaky find from Phelps.
Slimer with the score. And the Wildfire now up by 7.
And that is bookends for Slimer, who many, many throws ago got the D.
So he was open on both end zones on that play. Pittsburgh hit him well. And then Chicago coming back for the big play there.
Everyone loves throwing to Slimer.
Slimer, one of the true characters on the Chicago Wildfire Club, but he's also a very talented player. .346 left in the third quarter. Wildfire in total control now. So when you're getting beat like this, what is the tendency to try to just make a big play that isn't there and cost you like they just did?
Well, certainly if you're feeling desperate, you might have the tendency to allow mental lapses in both decision and execution. But there are still takeaways in a game that you are losing by 7 points. I mean, if there's anything we've learned about the AUDL, it's that these games are long. Gaps like this can be overcome. You know, you really have to buckle down and start executing in a very disciplined fashion, even though it feels like you need to make an enormous play in order to close the gap. There's enough time. That smart offense is going to win the game.
Wildfire turned the disc over. Pittsburgh trying to come up big on the play, but the disc falling out of the reach of Alex Thomas. And your Wildfire will take over. 2:36 left in your third quarter. It's the Chicago Wildfire 18, Pittsburgh 11. Alex Rummelhart on the disc, another one of the very talented and versatile players for the Chicago Wildfire Club. But Coach Adrian King wants to see the offense back, and he'll call timeout. So with 2:18 left in your third quarter, it's 18-11. Good guys.
We want to remind you that if you have a need for injury rehabilitation or physical therapy, call Healthy Care Rehabilitation, the exclusive partner and provider of certified trainers in injury rehabilitation of the Chicago Wildfire. With 33 locations throughout the Chicagoland area, they are sure to have a location near you. NovaCare, the power of physical therapy. Check out NovaCare online at novacare.com.
Welcome back to Benedetti Worley Stadium on the campus of North Central College. D. Mike and Meagles on the call. Your Wildfire up 18-11. Pavel Yanis will take over deep in his own end. Getting some fresh legs in there here to kind of give the offense a little bit of a break. Weiss up the left-hand side now, looking back towards the middle. Jeff Zhao. Zhao going deep, lays it out there. Up into the air was Danny Miller, but two Pittsburgh defenders there to close on the disc. Jeff Zhao made a nice play, but the disc just hanging up a little too much for Danny.
Yeah, I kind of wish that I had thrown the disc a little bit prior to the game. I'm surprised to see the number of long puts we're seeing end lofty and slow. When Zhao released that disc, I thought that's a surefire score for Miller. But as it neared the end zone line, it slowed down and lifted up, and that's how Pittsburgh was able to make a play on the disc.
What little wind we have, that was going upwind. And that seemed to kind of make it hang a little bit. Really weird down on the field, and the flags a whole lot different here at Benedetti Worley Stadium. In fact, some of the players were saying, and Pavel was telling me, that it's not much different than playing at Lane Tech Stadium, the way the terrain is around here and the way the stadium is, that the winds are a little on the swirly side.
And that can make it very difficult in terms of adjustments. If it's a strong wind but consistent, you know how to adjust your throws accordingly, and you just do that all game long. But if it's gusting, then as soon as it leaves your hand, you're at the mercy of whatever gust comes or doesn't come.
1 minute left in the third quarter. Timeout on the field, but we'll keep it here. I keep talking about next week, but I'm really looking forward to seeing what a few additions do for the Chicago Wildfire against those Madison Radicals. Last season, I think Chicago gave Madison more fits than just about any team in the league. And the Chicago Wildfire much improved this year.
Yes. The thing to bear in mind, though, is that Madison is good because they know how to close out games. So even when you think you have the advantage in the second quarter, even the third quarter, you know, it's not over until it's over. And Madison is good at doing what they need to do to close out the game. But as you said, Chicago has some really key additions this year. Madison also has some changes they need to make to improve their game. We'll see if the firepower and the intensity Chicago has added is enough to close out the powerhouse of the Midwest.
Pittsburgh working the disc up the right-hand side, knocking on the door for the score. This is really a must-score situation for Pittsburgh if they have any hope of getting back in this one. Chicago up by 7. Closing seconds of the third quarter, fires a disc into the end zone for the score. Nice play on the disc. Looked like number 22, Owen Watt, making the score.
With only inches left, Watt was able to pull that in. Watt, originally from Canada, has made an appearance on the Canadian national team, the youth national team. He played for the U19 Junior Worlds team in 2014. So clearly comes with the experience of playing in high-pressure situations. Helps explain how he can make a play like that with, like I said, literally inches to spare.
I think it was the big toe that got in there for the score there. Really close to the sideline, but good awareness of where he was on the field to make that play. Closing seconds of your third quarter. Wildfire trying to get it done here. Pavel, field's opening up down the right-hand side. Denny Miller now stuck back to Pavel. As time expires, Pavel going deep into the end zone, but Pittsburgh makes the play on the disc, and that will be the end of your third quarter. So at the end of three quarters of play out of your Benedetti Worley Stadium, it is your Chicago Wildfire 18, the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds 12.
A quick reminder, Wildfire players will be headed to Gordon Barrel after the game. Hope to see you there immediately following tonight's action.
Line
for a chance to win a new iPhone. What? iPhone? That was a rough throw. It might get there. There's number 2. Not bad at all. Now final contestant. Well, not too bad. Let's give our three contestants a round of applause.
Mike and Meagles back out here at Benedetti Worley Stadium on the campus of North Central College. And this is a beautiful facility to come out and watch Ultimate. And this game, Meagles, it's getting more and more exciting every year. And this year, I think the AUDL is really unpredictable. And I think we're going to see a little bit of that here in the Central Division as the year wears on.
Yeah, you could have said that just about any division. There have been surprises every corner. A lot of games won in overtime, won by a single point. This is the first time we've had games as close and as unpredictable as we have this year.
Pittsburgh getting very careless with the disc in their own end. Up the right-hand side. Swat to Bats. Back to Shepard. About 20 yards out from goal. Fires it into the end zone. Too high, but the second Pittsburgh player was there on the play. And that looked...
Ferdella going in to make the save.
Kenny Ferdella getting sort of the cleanup point on that one. And it's 18-13, Pittsburgh, or Chicago.
Yeah, you saw Jason Valley, who was defending Ferdella, put his hands on his head when he realized that Ferdella was going in to make that save. The AUDL is a great place to learn this lesson over and over, that the point is not complete until the disc is in the hands of a player. So understand, if it's in the air, somebody is going to make a play on it. Better make sure it's not your person.
So all of a sudden, Pittsburgh back within five. 11:17 left in regulation. Chicago will go back on offense. Pavlyanis and Max Trotter. The nice dynamic duo for the Wildfire tonight. Pardo. Working it up the middle of the field. Danny Miller. Miller back to Pavel. Pavel back to Danny Miller to Pavel. Pardo. To Pavel, but knocked out of the hands of Pavlyanis. So Chicago will maintain possession of the disc. Pavel about 20 yards out. Fires it up to Pardo. Pardo, nothing open. Bails it out back to Pavel. Pavel to Weiss. Back to Pavel. I like the way Weiss, right after he dishes the disc, he instantly makes his cut trying to get open. Pardo to Pavel. Pavel knocking on the door, and that's just a matter of time till a player comes open, and this time it's Jeff Zhao. Nice possession for the Chicago Wildfire, showing patience.
Yeah, good defense from Pittsburgh. They did a good job of making sure that they kept someone in the open lane after a player made a cut. So there was sometimes a poach there, sometimes not a poach there. It made Chicago look twice every single throw, which is why it took as many throws it did to get down to the end zone and then finally in the end zone. But as you said, great patience from Chicago. They didn't throw anything untowards. They really kept an eye down the field to see what was open. Was there a defender in the lane? Had to work hard for that point, but came up all the better for it.
Jeff Zhao, the ninth Chicago Wildfire player to get into the end zone tonight. It's a good balanced attack by your Wildfire. Now Pittsburgh quickly on the offensive attack. Wildfire up by six here, though. Inside of 10 minutes. And the Wildfire staling the desk quickly on the attack. Lays it out there, but too far. And Pittsburgh will take over. Chicago with that quick turnover trying for the big play. But Jack Shea couldn't quite corral the disc.
Yeah, Zeman should have held on to it for just a moment longer, especially because there wasn't a lot of coverage on Jack Shea.
Pittsburgh going deep, and they'll come up empty. So quickly, Chicago Wildfire getting the disc back. Dave Woods on the disc in his own end zone. This is when I get a little nervous watching up here in the booth.
Jimmy Sikora
down the right-hand side lays it up there, but the disc just floats into the hands of the Pittsburgh defender.
And that's another example of these discs just flowing slow and high at the end of their trajectory. It makes me wish I had had the opportunity to toss a few discs down the field to experience the wind myself.
Pittsburgh firing into the end zone, but not even close. That disc was about 5 yards away from the receiver.
And this is Chicago's third opportunity to make a play this point. And this is really what I was mentioning earlier. Chicago has to work on not beating themselves. They have to get better at capitalizing on the opportunities given to them a little bit sooner if they want to make a bid to win this division.
Chicago turning the disc over again, and Pittsburgh this time will get the disc into the end zone for the score. Getting it back within five. How tough is it for your line when you have a long, long point like that?
That's a great question. That's when the mental lapses really start to kick in. You feel like you have to be the one to make the appropriate play. You have to be the one to try and finish this point. You just want to get on the sideline. Even if that's not a conscious thought, the body starts to take over and the fatigue starts to take over. You start to take shots that are unnecessary, not executing as crisply and cleanly, and it leads to just careless, silly mistakes.
With a nice big lead, the only thing positive out of that whole exchange is that it ate about a minute 45 off the clock. Now we're down to 7.5 minutes left in the game, and the Chicago offense back on the field. Pavel Zhao and Max in no hurry to go deep here. Unless something comes wide open, they're going to be very content to just methodically work the disc up the field. Now Pardo and Weiss, little two-man game, and now back to Pavel, to Zhao, and back around to Max. Pardo right at midfield now with Pavel to Weiss. Just playing the old patented small ball here. Being nice and patient with the disc. Now Zhao looking downfield. Nothing there. He'll just bail it out to Pardo. Pardo to Max in and out of his hands. Usually sure-handed Max Trotter. The disc looked like it just kind of took off on him. And Pittsburgh will take over. Inside of 6.5 minutes now in the third quarter, and Pittsburgh on the attack. Max trying to come up with a big D. Max might be one of the smaller guys on the field, but, man, he can sky for that disc. Pittsburgh will call a timeout with 6:10 left in your fourth quarter. It's 19-14 Wildfire.
Thank you.
back here, Benedetti Worley Stadium, Pittsburgh, quickly on the attack inside of 6 minutes here in the fourth quarter. Traveling call against Pittsburgh. That'll cost him 10. It's about the third travel of the game for Shepherd. Pittsburgh on the attack. Shepherd back to the middle of the field to Van Dusen. Van Dusen to Beardsley. Back to Van Dusen. Van Dusen fires into the end zone for the score.
Tough put from Van Dusen.
Looked like Owen Watt on the play.
Yep, it was. Watt once again in the end zone, but you got to give credit to Van Dusen for being able to make that put.
19-15, Wildfire up by four. But they need to finish strong here. 5:18, that's a lot of time in AUDL action.
It certainly has. You know, the lead that Chicago has had the entire game has certainly ebbed and flowed. A few mistakes from Chicago, a few tight plays from Pittsburgh. They're back within five. Now, that is by no means an easily conquerable lead, but with 5 minutes left, it is possible.
What Chicago has going for them is a very smart offense here, because you know that Pavel and Max, they're going to take the big opening downfield like this. Pavel going deep. He's got Weiss out there, and Weiss in for the score. Pavel Giannis just ripped one down the field, and Jeff Weiss tracked it down. But again, he was open by about 5 yards on his Pittsburgh defender.
Yeah, you saw him working really well with Pardo at that point. Pardo made a quick in cut and then started to sprint deep. Pittsburgh very fast to react and close down that opportunity. So Pardo came back in. Weiss played off of him perfectly. And Giannis was very quick to capitalize on their downfield movement. Weiss, his timing, his play off of Pardo made him the perfect target for a long shot from Pavel Giannis.
That was the sixth goal of the night by Wetz, Jeff Weiss. Pardo with five, so the two big hitters on that cutter line for Chicago, both coming up big tonight. 4:56 left. Pittsburgh on the attack, down by five. That's Shepherd. Ooh, middle of the field, miss Van Dusen, but another Pittsburgh player there for the to clean it up. Shepherd firing cross field into the end zone, but the disc falls out of play. And Pittsburgh turning it over, and Chicago now will take over. Pavel on the disc for Chicago, going deep. Had Weiss out there, but too deep. And Pittsburgh will take over. 4 minutes left here in the fourth quarter. Chicago up by five. Pittsburgh with the disc. Beardsley working it up the right-hand side. Tolles. Tolles firing for the end zone. And that disc will fall out of play. So, again, Pittsburgh coming up empty, but I thought there was a whistle on the play, but I guess not.
Yeah, Pittsburgh really aiming to stretch the field now, but not able to connect with their players, giving Chicago plenty of opportunity to extend their lead.
3:20 left here in the fourth quarter, and Chicago back on the attack. After coming up empty the last possession, I think Chicago might be a little more patient here. Working the disc quickly to midfield. Now Pardo ripping one into the end zone. But that was tough for Was that Danny Miller out there trying to make the play?
No, that was Uber, Alex Rummelhart.
Pittsburgh will take over at their own goal line, 2:45 left. Chicago up 20-15. Now the clock starting to become the other defender against Pittsburgh here. Into the middle of the field, a nice play by Chicago. Max tried into the end zone for the score. Pardo on the score. It looked like a little bit of a desperate play there by Max for a little bit, but that disc sort of willed it into Pardo's hands for the score, and Chicago back up by 6.
Chicago has been really good at keeping themselves prepared and primed to strike as soon as the disc turns over. That play, Trotter picked up the disc, fired immediately. Pardo was prepared to make that cut. Again, another opportunity where Pittsburgh just didn't have the opportunity to put defense on, meaning that Chicago kind of had a free play for a point.
A 6-pack now for Mike Pardo on the night.
You said he was aiming to pad his stat sheet. He is not disappointed.
The thing is, Mike, a fantastic offensive player, but he's very unselfish. He'll play in the role the coach needs him to do. So if the other team's trying to shut him down, he'll kind of open up the field for the rest of the team like he's done tonight. But when he's got a chance to make the big play for the score, he never disappoints. Now Pittsburgh just throwing this right into the hands of the Chicago defender. And the Wildfire will take over, and we're under 2 minutes here. Slimer up the right-hand side. Slimer back to the middle of the field. Sikowski. Tries it up the left-hand side. Disc knocked out. Scott Trimble with the defensive play for Pittsburgh. Chicago in total command here, up by 6 with just a minute to play. Pittsburgh going into the end zone deep. Disc hanging up for an easy score for Alex Thomas.
We've talked about before how there isn't a term to describe when someone gets the D and then the assist. But that's just what happened for Scott Trimble. Made a great bid, D'd the disc away from Mike Egan, and then that was his great toss to Alex Thomas in the end zone.
21-16, Wildfire up by 6. 56.9 seconds left in this one. Meagles, I've been very impressed with the balanced scoring tonight. Both Mike Pardo and Jeff Weiss with a 6-pack. But 9 different players have scored for your Chicago Wildfire, and they are missing some of the key firepower. Guys like Kirk Gibson and Ross Barker. That's impressive to me that they've been in total command here.
Yeah, they've moved well together and off of one another. Playing against the defense well, reading what's open, what opportunities are available, and taking them very quickly. There's been so few points where you feel like the offense has been stagnant or players on the field aren't sure who needs to be moving, who needs to make the play. They're moving the disc very well together. I like the flow that I'm seeing from Chicago. They still are making a few unforced errors that they're going to have to rein in. And that's, it's still, we're not even... We're just about halfway through the season, so there's time to learn. But those are the kinds of adjustments that they'll need to continue to make in order to make themselves a stronger team.
6 seconds left. They're just counting it down. Jeff Weiss playing a little pitch and catch, and it's over, folks.
Your final score tonight out here at Benedetti Worley Stadium. It's the good guys, the Chicago Wildfire 21, the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds 16. Meagles, what an impressive performance by your Chicago Wildfire. And ain't the beer going to be cold tonight out there at the Board and Barrel Tavern. The food's pretty darn good over there as well.
It always tastes a little bit better after a victory. The Wildfire have a lot to be proud of. There have been adjustments that they've needed to make, that they have done so in this game. Still some lessons to be learned, but it's nice to walk away victorious and still have recognized what strengths and weaknesses exist on the team right now.
We'll be meeting you over there at the Board and Barrel in downtown Naperville in just a minute. Want to thank our other fine supporters here, the Chicago Wildfire this season, Body Armor. That is good stuff, folks, to hydrate with. The premium sports drink, the official premium sports drink of your Chicago Wildfire. The folks from NovaCare Rehabilitation keeping our boys in blue healthy this year. Friction Gloves, DiscStore.com, and Universal Points, the official cleats of your Chicago Wildfire. Meagles, it was a pleasure working with you out here again tonight, and I'm looking forward to listening to you and Evan on the call next week.
Well, the pleasure was all mine, and I, too, am very excited to come back and call another Chicago Wildfire game next week.
So for Meagles, this is D-Mike, Dennis Michelson, saying, come on out here next week, folks, to see the game of the year between your Chicago Wildfire and the Madison Radicals. We'll get it started off at 6 p.m. next Saturday night out here at Benedetti Worley Stadium on the campus of North Central College right here in downtown Naperville. So for Meagles, this is Dennis Michelson thanking our good, hardworking crew behind the scenes. And I know you enjoyed the outcome. I hope you enjoyed the broadcast. It's your Chicago Wildfire 21, the Pittsburgh Thunderbirds 16. Good night, everybody.